We didn't name it though, but I'll see if I can change it from here. Kind of space in a lot.
Good morning, folks. Thanks very much for coming. My name is Eric Wood. I'm with the firm HKS, and we've been retained by the University of Development Corporation to work with the town of Hicksville on this very exciting project. This is the first meeting of the local planning committee, so we're very excited that everybody has been able to come. And for our opening remarks, I'd like to invite us town supervisor John Saladino to welcome everybody.
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. I'm Supervisor Joseph Saladino on behalf of Councilman Anthony Magnone, Councilwoman Rebecca Alessia, our Nassau County Legislator Rose Walker, who's on her way, and one of the chairs, Deputy Supervisor Greg Carmen, as well as the other Town of Oyster Bay personnel. We'd like to welcome you for joining us here at this kickoff meeting of the Local Planning Committee for downtown Hicksville, and I have to tell you, it is very exciting to say that sentence. This meeting marks the official start of the next phase of this process and the planning efforts for this committee after the town won a $10 million grant from Governor Cuomo for downtown Hicksville revitalization. We're very proud that we won this. We're very proud to be working with all of you to create a beautiful new Hicksville. This committee, which is comprised of local and regional leaders, stakeholders, community representatives, helped to craft a community-based vision for revitalizing downtown Hicksville to create a most vibrant, progressive community. Community development always needs to balance the economic needs and benefits of businesses while preserving the suburban integrity that initially attracted our residents to this area. Downtown Hicksville has strong physical suitability for revitalization and redevelopment, as evidenced by a high Long Island Railroad ridership, intensity of existing commercial land uses, infill-ready parcels, a converging arterial roadway system, and ample sewer and utility infrastructure. Hicksville is also poised to capitalize on the strong transit-oriented development market and the Long Island Railroad third track improvements through the implementation of a strategic zoning initiative, walkability enhancements, parking management, and storefront beautifications, to name but a few. Downtown Hicksville is on the verge of a major renaissance. With New York State's $10 million grant and the MTA's $132 million investment in the Hicksville Railroad Station, we can transform Hicksville and our community into a vibrant downtown for millennials, downsizers, empty nesters, senior citizens, and families alike. The end result of successful downtown revitalization efforts are new jobs, new housing opportunities, and the implementation of aesthetic improvements like an attractive, walkable, and bicycle-friendly environment. My town board colleagues have worked so hard to help to bring today to fruition, and we continue to work diligently to advance plans for downtown Hicksville, which have already included public meetings to gather input from our residents, business community, and so many of the stakeholders. The downtown's prime location for transit-oriented development and public support for revitalization, coupled with the state's investment and funding, will allow downtown Hicksville to achieve the type of revitalization it needs and, quite frankly, we deserve. We very much look forward to making this dream for downtown Hicksville a reality, and we so look forward to continuing to work with each and every one of you to bring that reality to our, to match our vision. We thank you again for your part in helping this very important project come to fruition, and we look forward to everyone's continued participation as additional meetings, including public workshops, will be scheduled this year and early into next year. Thank you again for being here, and now it's ready to get started on this very, very exciting voyage.
So I'd like to introduce our co-chairs of the local planning committee. That's Gregory Carmen, as well as Dave Capel. Would you like to make some remarks as well?
Well, my remarks will be more brief. Supervisor let us off very well over here. Again, it's very exciting to be a part of joining something that's very important to the Hicksville community, and to work with many of you, some of you who have invested many years in getting us to this point. It's been 6 or 7 years of working in the community to get us to this stage, this planning process, and it's exciting that we have a $10 million grant that we've been awarded by the state to really jumpstart this initiative and getting us through the planning process that come over the plan. As I understand, as we move forward in here, our first step in the incentive here is to create a plan to revitalize the downtown area. Over the next 6 months, this committee here will be charged with making sure we develop that plan for the community. We intend to have monthly local planning meetings, as well as a minimum of 3 community meetings, which will be open to the public so that we can have their meaningful input and their participation in the process. At the end of this planning process, we should expect to have a strategic investment plan in place, which will be funded with a generous DRI award of the $10 million. This is really something that is going to be very special for the Hicksville community and for the residents of the town of Oyster Bay. It's unprecedented with what we're doing over here. And we look forward to the partnership with the state and their support in helping us to achieve this. Two other people I'd like just to acknowledge in here as being important members of our team would be Eric Alexander of Division Wamama and Lionel Chitty, who's an individual who has invested a tremendous amount of time and energy in this community, making this effort real. With that said, I'd like to introduce my co-chair. That would be Dave Capel. He had the opportunity to participate in the Westbury DRI and is a former mayor of Greenport.
Yes, sir.
Dave.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's a humbling experience to be here and serve in this role in the process that we're about to go through. Hicksville is an incredibly important nexus for Long Island. It's really exciting to be involved and seeing it come back and move forward. My role here really is representing the Long Island Regional Economic Development Council along with my colleague Linda Armand, Secretary of Federal Savings. We both of us served on the committee that reviewed and considered the various applications for the DRI grant this year. Hicksville was far and away the most impressive proposal, so we're delighted to be here to support it now that it's moving into the implementation phase. As my co-chair mentioned, I served on the Westbury Local Planning Committee last year. In the same process that we're about to go through here, I also was co-chair with Mayor Peter Cavallaro. The one thing I learned from that experience that I want to share with you is that the most important thing here is to keep an open mind as we work through the process of planning for the use of the money. I know that a lot of thought has gone into, a lot of good thought and good work has gone into the process that's gotten us here, but now it's an opportunity to work again and see if there are any additional ideas that can come forward to help improve on the plan. Most importantly is that the should serve as leverage for private investment. $10 million alone, we seem to lose that in a heartbeat in a place as large as Hicksville with the needs that we've got. So it's critical that the investment of that money serves to leverage additional investment by the private sector to realize the goals that we have in mind, and that it serves as a game changer for Hicksville going forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
At this point, I'll ask if the committee members would introduce themselves, please, starting with David Chung.
My name is Rafan Qureshi. I'm with ATB Bank New York, and we have a branch down the street over here. We are a small community bank out of New York, and I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Linda Armin. I'm representing the RAP, as Dave said, and I'm also senior vice president of the Federal Credit Union, which is just up the block.
My name is Lionel Chitty. I am the private senator of the Chamber of Commerce. After 9 years, but right now I'm the executive director of the Hicksville Chamber of Commerce, and I'm also the chair of the Revitalization Committee, and I am absolutely ecstatic that this is moving forward in the project. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Anthony McAdam, Councilman Chung of Worcester Bay. I've been working on this along with many members here for quite a few years. I'm seeing Eric Nodden. It's been a dream come true. I'm also senior representative for the NASA for the Long Island Carpenters Union. And we're looking forward to building here at Hicksville.
Down in Worcester Bay, Supervisor Joseph Saladino, also thrilled to bring this project to fruition.
Gregory Farman, the Deputy Supervisor of the Town of Worcester Bay, prior to joining the town in February. I'm an attorney who has been in private practice with a concentration in real estate and banking. And I'm really welcoming the opportunity to be part of this project.
Not just for the grant, but for giving us the opportunity to have tremendous planners and professionals working on this project with us. We really appreciate the help and the guidance.
I'm Rosemary Walker. I'm one of the legislators here in Jasper County. This is where I built our home for my entire 66-plus years today. But I'm so very excited, and as many people have said, I feel like this has been a dream for a long, long, long time. Any of you in this room, and I'm so happy to see it really becoming a reality. So thank you all, and look forward to working with you.
John Sarcone, Director of Housing for the Family, also the Chairman of the National Family Land Bank, and a proud people resident.
Paul Molinari, I've been a Hicksville resident for almost 40 years. I'm a retired professional engineer. I served on the Hicksville Downtown Revitalization Committee for 6-7 years, and I'm a member of Duffy Park and Hicksville Garden Civic Association.
I'm Phil Hightock, also a retired professional engineer. I've been Paul from previous work life. Also on the Revitalization Committee for about 7 years, along with several of the people in the back of the audience behind us. I'm currently president of the Hicksville School Board, a member of the Hicksville Garden Civic Association.
Good morning, my name is Sunita Magical. I'm the Director of Employment Programs for Nassau County Department of Social Services. I'm also a member of the Hicksville School Board and a 15-year Hicksville resident, not as long as a few, but I've been in and I can't wait to see how excited I am to make sure that the contributions are sheet and regulations of Hicksville.
So Mr. Coley's on the way.
Excellent, excellent. Well, I wanted to applaud everybody for being here. I think that this is an extraordinary opportunity. in the morning to convene. This is our very first meeting of the local planning committee. And so we wanted to be able to start a conversation and figure some things out together. What we're going to talk about are a couple different things. First is going to be an overview of the downtown revitalization initiative and what that means for Hicksville. And look at the work that has been done in the past to bring us to this point where there is a vision or a notion of visions for what the downtown should be. We'd like to confirm and invite discussion about any other ideas that people have, particularly just focusing in around the downtown region, not just all of Hicksville. There is a process that we're going to talk about, which will invite community input and have conversations not just within this setting, but with other stakeholders and community members all throughout the entire process. So we'll talk a bit about how that gets done. And towards the end of this conversation today, we'll figure out what the next steps will be. In specific, how often this particular committee, the local planning committee, will meet, when we will meet, and what time of day we'll meet. We picked this particular time just to get started, thinking that most people would have some time in the morning in order to be able to jumpstart this committee. But we'll invite suggestions from the members as to what might be more convenient for you moving forward. That said, I'd just like to review some of the responsibilities and privileges of being a member of the local planning committee. The first and foremost, since this is the downtown revitalization initiative, is to really help establish what the vision for the downtown will be. It means brainstorming ideas, providing instruction and direction to lead consultants as we move forward through the work. It's reviewing the drafts of the documents that the DRI actually will produce. It will help, it would also involve helping us reach out to various different populations within Hicksville so that we are able to get their input. Because not everybody's going to be able to make each and every meeting. Not everybody uses the internet. Not everybody uses various different forms of media, so we're trying to do a broad cast of different ways to get people together. And then to help us identify and prioritize the projects that we will look at for this particular session. And also at the very end, we're going to develop and submit the strategic investment plan for this downtown revitalization initiative. We have some resources to pull upon for this committee. Two of those people are from the state. One is from the Department of State. That's Jim Ashton. He's a fellow sitting up there.
David Ashton.
David, I'm sorry. Right. And then we have Dominic Martello, also from the state.
Good morning.
HCR. He's over there. Those two people help to organize the DRI and will provide a great resource for this body to call upon if we have questions about the kind of projects that could be funded through this process, even some of the civil aspects of it. I will be one of the people as the primary contact person with those. So if you have final questions to me, I will make certain that they get to Dave, but they're also available. So the consultant team is composed of a bunch of different people. In this process, the Empire State Development Corporation, in conjunction with the Department of State, runs the DRI program. And last spring, they had issued a call for different firms to respond to this request for proposal. My firm responded. And at that point, it was unknown what township we might be partnered to. The state, in essence, accepted applications from 10 different downtowns that they eventually awarded. And then they met matched us up as consultants with each of those townships. So our team was very lucky to be paired up with Pittsville. So the team leadership is done by HPS. We're primarily an architectural urban design firm. We have as our public engagement specialist a group called Zetman Strategic Communications. Patrick Hewitt is sitting at the end, representing that group. For our market studies and economic development strategies, we have public planning. Todd Poole here represents that group. We also have Borough Havelt Engineering, who will be our traffic engineer. Langen is going to focus on utility infrastructure. And then for understanding order of magnitude costs, we have Long Island-based Toscano Clements Taylor. And because this is the first time that you're getting to meet we, the master planners and team leaders here, I thought I'd just show you a few projects to give you a sense of what we've done and what experience we're bringing to the table. One of the things that we have done recently, this is very much aligned to this particular assignment, was working with civic leaders in downtown Toledo and figuring out a strategy of how to use and leverage their best asset, in this case being the river, so that it can encourage greater economic development. Similarly, in St. Petersburg in Florida, the city was interested in taking property that surrounded a baseball stadium, it was a Major League Baseball stadium where the Tampa Bay Rays play, and seeing how much additional development could be done around a stadium. We just completed that piece of work. We also did a piece of work in Stamford, Connecticut for a private developer who was very much interested in leveraging the waterfront, but also the proximity to the train station there for higher density residential development, and this project actually is coming out of the ground. More recently, we've been working for an institution, this being St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital, on their campus, figuring out how to bring new buildings within that established campus and still keep the sense of smallness that is very appropriate for the kind of deliberate care and research. On the other spectrum, we've done very large things. Randy Morton, who is the principal with HPS as part of our team, had worked with Cecil Backler, one of our senior designers, on the Hudson Yards framework now almost 15 years ago, or 10 years ago. That framework was looking at redeveloping a large section of the west side of Manhattan, roughly 30 blocks. And when the developer was finally chosen, we had helped Tishman Speyer work on their particular proposal for that build-out. And this is a depiction of some of the open spaces that we were proposing for them then. And on the smaller scale end of things, Randy was the designer for Zutani Park. And I think for the kinds of projects that we're looking to do out of this $10 million grant, it may more be on this scale of things. We are mostly looking from the materials that we've read and the comments that we've already heard, and invite certainly many more comments, that there's a great desire to have more spaces for people in Pittsville together. It may be this kind of space. Hopefully it won't be an Occupy Wall Street kind of space. So the responsibilities of the consulting team consist of just helping to prepare and organize meetings for the IPC, to do the public outreach organization, to continue to do research and investigate issues that come up in the IPC community, but also to actually help you guys identify the projects that want to be supported by this committee and the citizens of Pittsville, so that at the end of this entire work process, we have honed in on the things that matter most to you and the things that we believe can be best implemented using. So the overview of the program is that we're in the second round, as it were, of the program. It was established last year. The state has put in $100 million and have identified 10 different downtowns that they thought could leverage each $10 million for different projects that could help turn the tide for them. And so in this round in 2017, Hicksville is one of those. So these specific strategic investment plans will help fund not only public-sponsored projects, but also consider sponsoring private projects, particularly if there's a gap in the funding that's necessary in order to make that project happen. So these are the 10 different sectors that the DRR program has broken the state into. They're down here. But there are others that are undergoing the same process simultaneously. So what the program that we're working on now is trying to build on the application that was submitted. In that application, there were certain desires, but the clearest desire here was to have a very robust public engagement process, and I'll talk about that in a minute. So the process that we're going to undertake in this committee is to help refine the vision. Fortunately, you guys have been working on what you think should happen in downtown Hicksville for nigh on a decade. So I think people have a good sensibility about what those things are. So what we're trying to do in these sessions is to update that, confirm it with what we think this particular time frame needs and what kinds of things might get started now that have a long-term impact for the better on this building. Simultaneously, we'll be focusing on the goals and how we can reach those goals. But more specifically, we're going to be working on tactical strategies for how to make that happen. So I mentioned there's going to be a public engagement process. At minimum, we're holding three public workshops. The first one will be on district priorities, effectively doing something similar to what we're talking about here, but talking to a larger audience. The second one will focus on district projects, and the third one will speak more directly to strategic investments. So our first public workshop will happen on November 9, here in this room. That is a Thursday. We'll start at 7 p.m. and run approximately until 9:30. We are planning to have it with a small presentation in the beginning to get people oriented and an overview, and then go through small conversations about specific issues. So I hope to see everybody in this room there on November 9. Bring your friends, bring your family members. So the ingredients of a DRI plan entail these things. It needs to have a clear vision for downtown, identify the specific goals and strategies to accomplish that vision. Again, Hicksville has done a lot of work to get there so far, so this is a light lift right now. But more specifically, we're going to have an action plan with a timeline for these projects, initiatives, and actions. And that's the primary work of this LTC membership. So I hope you guys are all ready to dig down into that process. And ultimately, we'll have a strategic investment plan with those kind of projects identified so that we can go forward with an implementation plan. And there's a bunch of different particulars that the DRI plan needs to meet in order to satisfy the Department of State's requirements, and we kind of break down into the vision plan and the project profiles. So we can get into that further as we break down into smaller conversations. So the DRI is bounded, as you see here, pretty much the central business district. The LIRR station is the prime asset within this district. And I think everybody understands that that's what we need to leverage with almost all of our strategies for growth and investment here. So with all of the work that's been done, what has culminated is a proposal for zoning that was put out in 2016. Some of that might include higher density residential, putting retail underneath residential, increasing the FAR, floor area ratio, for building types. All those things are proposals. Those are ideas that are being contemplated. Nothing's been put forward for approval and voting. So part of what this group can do is weigh in on what kinds of things may occur for this rezoning. That rezoning had a vision, which was prepared in 2010 by A.B. Collins, that pretty much looked at a variety of uses. And I know that this is a little bit difficult to view at this point, in part because they put north-south. So relative to the plan that is here, this point is that point there. So this is a starting point for us. It had identified a couple of different projects in it, and the application also identified various different projects. So we'll talk a lot about this. I think this is a very important slide, and hopefully if there's nothing else that you take away from this meeting, this is one that you'll keep in mind. There's been, as we've been mentioning, a lot of district planning going on. There's the 2001 Hazel Hamlet Plan, the 2004 Hazel Vision Plan, the 2010 Downtown Hazel Revitalization Action Plan. In 2014, there were the two applicable POAs for Northwest and the Southeast, and the 2016 rezoning for the CPD. Now, we're here. This is an important moment in this flow of investment. This is a time when we have to take a breath, look at what it is that we're trying to accomplish, and then put it into action. The DRI grant was awarded in August. September 15th is when we had the first conversation and convening of the township with the consulting team. The process is to be completed in March of 2018. After that, the investment plans should start to flow into the future and bring new boards. So specifically in this 5-month time frame that we're looking at, we're starting with an analysis of the district, a review of the documents that have been done, giving the project team an ability to chat with you guys so that we're up to speed with what you think is most important. We're then moving directly to identifying those priority projects through exploring and testing different ideas and seeing how well they might fit or not. Then coming up with a strategic investment plan. All of those three activities are consistently informed by our public and big engagement conversations. So we'll have a public workshop November 9th. We'll have another one likely in December. Haven't picked that date yet. And another one in February of next year. So the project types are plentiful, but there are some things I'll just underscore so the membership of the LPC can keep that in mind. Is that the funding of the $10 million will not go towards planning activities, will not go to staff costs or training expenses. It really is focused more on bricks and mortar, things that would make the physical environment improved here in Hicksville. So that could be from publicly identified spaces and possibly for projects. Again, it's mostly looking at private projects that are in need of gap funding that would be considered here. So I want to take you through a few little observations that we've had a little bit of time on the ground here to make. So very clearly everybody recognizes that Hicksville has a marvelous connection to the rail system, that getting from many parts of Long Island to Hicksville allows an express train to go right into Penn Station. The flow of people, because of its location, to me to capture people's dollars. We have a lot of potential to build up the value of real estate adjacent to the train station. The question before us is how to do so. We also recognize that Pittsville has this marvelous north-south connection. One of the things that you guys have done back in the 60s was to widen that roadway. The roadway in the 40s was more narrow and had an intimacy of scale on it. And in part, the zeitgeist of the 60s wanted to speed cars along and to accommodate great volumes of cars. This is what we have today. So I don't think we could bring back the imagery and character of the 40s. But the question is, what can we do to bring it forward, moving onward? A couple of things that we've been, of course, noticing. I know that you guys live it every day. But it's just the general level of congestion that starts to build up. At certainly specific points of day, but it happens a lot throughout the day. Along Broadway, which if we're suggesting that Broadway is the locus of downtown activities, the conflict of that traffic volume with what we're trying to encourage with pedestrian use of a downtown begs how we're going to actually ameliorate and support one kind of activity versus another. Lots of places for improvement, specifically around the train station. One of the strategies I know that you guys are focusing on is, okay, to this motto here, let's replace your gas station with a train station. I think that's a very good way to think about how to leverage the asset that's here. Bringing people through this area, I think, is the right first step. How do we leverage that even further? How deepen that is something that we're going to explore in this committee at great length. So we did a little doodle just to start figuring out on paper what some of those thoughts might be. Looking at the train station and its extension, we don't have to squint at this too hard because we're not going to blow on it that long. This is just putting on paper some ideas about what happens when we think about not Broadway being downtown, but maybe it's a downtown district around the train station. It's just one of the things that, based on our experiences and our observations here, is one of the directions that we would like to explore more deeply. So at this point, since we're at 9:15, and we want this meeting to run through about 10:30, I'd like to start talking about some of the ideas that's already been put forward in the DRI application. And get people's thoughts about what we might want to support, what we might want to get rid of right away, or things that we might think about that even aren't as a part of this list. So there was a notion of a downtown path that would link a lot of the areas within the downtown region. There's a notion of having an elevated community space, the High Line. There's a notion of having an event space at Pedestrian Plaza, the notion of many parts throughout this area, the notion of having greater signage that would link these different things together and create a distinctive identity for the region. And there was the notion of mitigating traffic. I think that's a no-brainer, just how we go about do it so that other land uses are better supported. So let's just pick on somebody. Tony, in this list of things, which one do you think you would like to, if you had one choice, which one would you choose to put forward?
Traffic mitigation.
Okay.
I'm here for the fire department, and you know, our responses are an issue, so traffic is a problem, which we know. We're all in favor of the revitalization, but traffic is definitely an issue.
And is there something out of this list that you would say don't need to invest in it at all?
Yeah, it's all good.
Okay. Is there something on this list that you don't see that you'd like to add?
No, right now, no.
Okay. Rebecca, how about you?
I'll just have a call for me. High Line's been sort of my adopted child, but I think the pedestrian plaza, from the meetings and we tried several times to find that. So I would say that community congregation, whether it's the first or the second option, is very important.
And is there anything on this list that you don't see that you'd like to add?
Does parking fall, parking issues, do they fall under the purview of this same committee, or is that separate?
Sure.
That's a planning issue.
We're open to all things right now.
I think parking is a major problem for people in this.
So you would like to see more parking conditions?
I'm not saying that necessarily. I'm just saying I think we need kind of a, in conjunction with these things, which are hopefully going to bring more people, I think we need to come up with an idea of where these people, hopefully they'll leave their cars at home, but if they have their cars, we need to think of where to put them.
Sunita, do you have comments?
Well, as a girl parent, I'm thinking of the future generation. I like the idea of the pedestrian project, where the families can get together and feel that community feel. I know we tried that with the farmers market, and I used to rush there on Sunday mornings. We didn't have that, so we take advantage of that. But I definitely think the pedestrian project is very important. So that's what's missing right now. Mm-hmm. I think parking is an issue, but I think we have all these wonderful things, but we're able to park.
Paul, what would be some of your ideas?
May I like the pedestrian plaza that was one of our focus there on expanding JFK Park. Now that would be increasing, now taking that one in the parking lot and expanding the park. I've always been big on traffic communication, which many people just would hang up or embrace it, traffic communication. As if you establish a pedestrian plaza, and then the issue of parking, right now the town of Oyster Bay parking garage is closed on weekends. If you're going to have weekend events, that would be an option to have that open to the park. All the rest of you, I like more about it.
I thought you should mention what you just whispered, just the idea of using garages in an
efficient way. The town of Oyster Bay parking garage is closed on weekends. That's 1,400 spots, approximately 1,400 spots. That if they open it up on the weekends to the general public, the parking lots around the town, the train station, are open to everybody on the weekends. You don't need a permit. Right there you have 1,400 potentially available spots to accommodate any events during the on a weekend.
Ronnie, do you have thoughts that you'd like to share?
Yeah, the High Line is pedestrian plaza. It's really exciting. 130 Mile Life is 29. We constantly bring our friends into town, and round one has been a wonderful thing to be able to invite people to have time to visit us. My son is in second grade. He's looking for places he can play with his friends that aren't so high traffic. I don't want to put him on the avenue with the train behind me, but it can be a little dicey with the narrow street there, too much traffic. The only thing I have to say negative about the traffic mitigation thing, it's a really tough endeavor to do that. The 1932 World's Fair, they had a list of 100 things they thought that humanity would achieve by the end of the century. We did every single thing on that list, from open heart surgery to putting a man on the moon, except for solving traffic jams. And being a tech guy, one of the things that I talk about countrywide is the driverless cars and the conversions of augmented reality, looking out of the window and having the car, all this glass that you're not using to see the road becoming a screen and things like that. Within the next 10 to 15 years, I would love to see Hitsville as part of a pilot program for driverless, which would be amazing, which that would be the only solution to traffic mitigation, is removing the human element from the suggestion and the decision making, at least in that zone. So we could have like a concentric bullseye around just the downtown that maybe cars wouldn't be driverless everywhere, but just passing through that zone for both safety and also for removing the decision making about green lights and things like that. You could see that efficiency come without spending this money in the next decade.
And would you suggest that when driverless cars happen in that ring that you're speaking of, that the roads could become narrower?
100%. Yeah, the statistics show that it's safer if the roads are narrower. Right now, the current average width, I think, is 14 feet, something like that. People actually are less crazy, less darting in and out of traffic, less lazy, kind of roaming in the lane if the lanes are narrower, according to every statistic.
spoke, you mentioned that you've been involved in pushing and preventing planning here for a while. So if you look at this list, are there things that you would like to champion above all others?
For me, I can't pick up a specific one. As I look at the entire area, I always said that Hicksville should be a place where people can work, live, play, shop. Residential components, I'm also a trustee for Sumio Westbury, and we constantly talk with the Chamber of Commerce about how do we attract some of that younger crowd to come down, participate in the area, do whatever they like to do as far as keeping some active things of that nature. The event, pedestrian plaza, that's absolutely fantastic, but again, I always feel that things go hand in hand with everything else, whether it's companies that are here that are looking to attract the right talent. They have issues as far as the residential component is concerned and other things to do within the area. So I feel that they all go in conjunction with each other. But again, that event space, I think that's also important to the residential component. Mm-hmm.
So out of this list, is there something that you would like to sort of diminish or degrade?
No, absolutely.
Okay. How about Linda?
So I was very excited about the elevated community space and or the pedestrian plaza and the way we're going through the process of the application. I like the idea of the elevated community space because of the traffic and the parking and getting it up higher, thinking that that would help mitigate a little bit. But I think that that would be my first two priorities. I like the idea of the downtown path, but I thought that the other two would be a higher priority.
Rose Walker.
I agree with Tony. The traffic mitigation is such a major issue. I live over by the close to the Westbury, such a big part of the downtown parkway. And at certain times of day, utterly ridiculous because the road doesn't move, the train doesn't move, it's a little crazy. Love the idea of the High Line and pedestrian plaza. And I even think some of the things that we tried before, as I said to Rebecca, you know, we had the farmer's market, I think it was great, but it was a parking lot. Like, just, you know, wasn't very inviting to people if you had it. You know, I see how great it is that we can have a Tangerette, let's say, the farmer's market out there. You know, obviously it's a shopping area, but people are there already, but it's just the whole setup is so different. I'd like to get a little bit more information about the signage. I mean, was that one of the things in Hicksville where people complain to me about, that, you know, with signs that they for everything on the blowing things, you know, this and that. They don't want, you know, I think signage is important, but I think we have to look at how it's done. It's a very big issue. And then we also talk about possibly in that area to keeping vehicles more out of the area, to have maybe a trolley, something that goes through the area. And people enjoy that too. And if, you know, kids love to do that, so family-wise, it's nice to have something like that.
So what I'm hearing right now is that there's a fairly broad support for High Line. There's a strong consensus about traffic mitigation issues. Let me pose a question to you. One of the things that's going to start making a downtown very activated is if you actually have people living in downtown as well. So part of what the proposed 2016 rezoning would do is to allow for higher density residential to be placed in that region.
Just one thing about traffic. We really could use a reliable bus service going north and south. So people won't be driving into Hicksville, they'll be taking a bus in, or if they're working in the office box of Jericho Syosset, having a reliable bus up, go from the train station up there, so after work they come back down, maybe they'll meet somebody for dinner in Hicksville, walk around the High Line and the elevated plaza and have a great time. But right now we don't have that. Everybody has to drive here to go to Hicksville. We had a reliable bus service. And north and south of Long Island is awful, as we all know. 135, morning or afternoon, Lonto Parkway, Meadowbrook, or the Sagatos is just terrible.
Yes,
a
comment on this, that projects like the elevated community space, the pedestrian plaza, make a lot of sense for Hicksville. That coupled with a program that ties these projects together, much like the Chicago waterfront there downtown, where you have signage and branding that brings about a vibrant community and connects all of these projects as developed as one. Clearly, Councilman McEnone brings up a very good point. As we look at more parking, we have this tremendous need for buses or trolley, something to handle the north-south traffic. And in terms of traffic mitigation, very, very important to ease congestion without diverting that traffic into residential side streets. We've seen that problem in other parts of Long Island. So we have to be very careful while we ease traffic, we don't move that problem into the residential side streets. But in terms of creating as much community space, event space, the High Line, giving people an opportunity to travel east, west, and north, south without using their cars, and this downtown, uniform downtown space that draws people as the key destination. It's, I believe, very helpful, and the vision that I've heard in having conversations with some of the residents.
So, just building off of that comment, since
And again, just to tie in with that, you know, if you take a look at it, we have three colleges up the road, and a lot of those students really don't have anything to do. So again, doing something to generate that traffic throughout the course of the day. Middle of the day, you have the lunch crowd, breakfast, whatever the case may be. A lot of people come down. There are different types of restaurants, but on something like the work of concrete to attract that younger crowd, keep them engaged here in Hicksville, and also seriously take a look at the residential component.
So, yes, sir.
Pretty much along the same lines of the discussion. Recently, in Hicksville, a main program has been people with properties, which find a business and becomes a commuter parking lot, a available parking lot. And so, one of the properties for the night, and several of us attempted to walk the center of Hicksville on Saturday evening along the lines of, you know, being out of the place. And it's special because you just have a parking lot, a parking lot that empty and dangerous. Not only the parking lot, but the converted commuter lots, the monthly commuter lots, and it takes up a huge part of the downtown. And as a result, it's kind of desolate, and truck traffic flies through top speed, 7, 8 o'clock at night on Saturday night. So, the need is to provide structures so that we can gradually move away from the surface parking lots that are using up the downtown and creating our tax base. Because gradually over the last few years, the residential school tax has gradually moved, and I know it is on part of it, but has moved from commercial to residential. So although in many cases we've generally raised the school tax, went up anyway.
So are there populations my generation.
There's a dual, not mine, I'm too old.
No.
I think there's a dual opportunity here, because I think we have, you know, the boomers and people that are aging out of their larger homes in the surrounding areas, in the suburban areas of Hicksville and surrounding. And I think a walkable area and a place that they can downsize into is a great opportunity as well. It doesn't just have to be about the young people.
Mm-hmm. I think being the father of two millennials that moved off Long Island because of the opportunities, I think we need young people housing. And unfortunately reaching that age, or fortunately reaching that age where I'm looking to downsize, I'd like to see senior housing there also. Maybe both generations getting together. Next generation housing and senior housing would be wonderful.
I know there's been experiments to do co-living where you have a 22-year-old person living under the same roof, though they're strangers, with somebody who's in their 60s. Would you think something like that might embrace
you? You're going to be the first one. The beautiful thing about Hicksville, we've got a little bit of everything. Like Councilwoman Leslie alluded to, we've got the young, old, everybody, family, starting off, kicking off, whatever the case may be. And we need to keep that in mind. I know it's not a huge area, we just can't start throwing something together. But again, there should be a little bit of something for everybody, keeping in mind moving forward how the demographics are going to change in the area. Mm-hmm. Hicksville's always been a spot where over the years things slowly change, and it's going to have a significant impact as far as what we do moving forward.
Ryan.
Yeah, I see a lot of these things as intertwined, but I wanted to comment about, I have an office in Dumbo, Brooklyn. That area just exploded once companies like Etsy and WeWork, which is where I have an office, had a setup. I would love to see some kind of space, whether it's not dedicated to it or not, it doesn't really matter, but more places for young entrepreneurs or startups or even students coming out of those universities are starting to develop different products. To want to stay here, to be close to where they can work together. So a co-working space to me would be most exciting. I had to struggle to put three offices where my employees work because I couldn't get them to move here. You know what I'm saying? So that's a struggle that I've had to face here. And I think we can solve that problem and bring in more business that would vitalize Hicksville by having the economic benefit of those companies grow from here out if there was a place for them to congregate and work there.
I have a question. Yeah, Ryan, as a follow-up to that, do you think it would have been easier for you to attract employees to come work out here if the reverse commute had been easier on the railroad?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, for sure.
So the third track process may help address that.
Yeah.
That's one of the principal benefits.
They all say it. All my friends are like, wow, this one's really got great bones. And I'm like, you have no idea that if you live here, you're really here every day. The fact that there are 17 different ways to go home to my house from the ball parking lot is incredible. We have great infrastructure. We've got good, amazing restaurants, great businesses, great people. If you talk to your neighbors, you find out that there's these wonderful people with amazing stories all around you for inspiration. My son goes to an amazing school. Everything is incredible here except for the way that businesses can get together or grow or start or sprawl.
Great seeing this come to fruition. When you look at areas such as West John Street, even W Avenue, they call it W Avenue IDA Way because there's so many newer businesses that have been popping up. You're talking hundreds upon hundreds of people that actually work there. When I went to an open house for a manufacturing company that actually came into Hicksville probably about a year and a half ago, I'm talking to him and he goes, I can't attract the right talent. And that's because it's not there, and if you try to pull from elsewhere,
there's no place for them to live. There's nothing else to do in the area. So again, I know a lot of people get a little skittish about it, but you need to keep in mind that residential component. It goes residential, the ease of being able to move around, transit-oriented development, the events, everything comes together. And I think that's what's a good portion to make great housing.
I have to piggyback on that. You talk to the head of Cold Spring Harbor Labs. This is no one can complain about attracting talent. Is there's no place affordable for them to live. So I think we have to think about something like that as revitalization.
Well, that was like, you know, one of the main focuses of this committee. We focused on the zoning changes as being the critical, you know, thing to track. We had originally proposed three zones and you know, talking about two zones, but it's basically the same. And, you know, but it's like, look at it. People in Pittsburgh do not want to be Mineola. They want to be more like the Farmingdale model. They want, and that's the proposed zoning that we had, was for like stores, the townhouses, apartments, condos, with like a three-story limit. And the commercial district, you know, downtown Pittsburgh is zoned right now, commercial district, five stories. We changed that to limit to four stories. So, you know, the residents have finally, after many, many years of fighting change, Pixel had gotten on the board. You know, the town had two public meetings about proposed zoning changes. One meeting was, you know, everybody was really afraid. The next meeting, you had some, you know, you had the naysayers come out. But the general feeling in Pixel as residents is now the time, it's time to change, redevelop the downtown area. We want it. And then, you know, we talked about Duffy Avenue. I live in the Duffy Park area. I walk Duffy Avenue every day. And that, in the last couple of years, you had New York Community Bank redeveloped the Plaza area. You have Zionic that renovated completely beautiful building, beautiful. The other commercial buildings owned by Long Island Industrial Management Corp, they've redone their facades. So most of the commercial buildings on Duffy Avenue are really good now. The only problem now with Duffy Avenue is I'm trying to address is the flow of traffic. There's going to be a lot of traffic on Duffy Avenue because you have so many businesses that are occupied. But that's good. Greg, do you have a comment?
There's a lot of talk about Farmingdale. Farmingdale, about 10 years ago, pretty much a lot of them storefront businesses were really struggling. I'm a resident of Farmingdale. I've been most of my life. My law practice is there in the heart of the village of Farmingdale. And about 10 years ago, I was the village attorney. I had the opportunity to actually start out at a time and advise the board that we really need to do some planning. And the person we brought into the building farm was Eric Alexander. And we started a visioning process there. And it evolved over time, over a period of 10 years, what we have now. It's a great community. There's been a lot of building. But we've also learned right now in the village of Farmingdale, we're bringing all these people in. And we need to have a lot of sensitivity as to how we, some of the challenges we have now. We have some new challenges. New challenges such as our ability to move in and out of the village. We continue to make improvements with different traffic patterns, but parking is horrendous. One of the challenges we have in Farmingdale, we don't have any parking garages. But it's something that we're gonna, you know, this is a much grander level, but the challenges we find that through the course of the day, it's very difficult to move in and out, even as residents. Who now live in the apartment buildings, who want to get to the businesses actually struggle to get their clients into them. So it's just some simple observations. A lot changed in a very short period of time. We've seen the challenges of having empty storefronts. So now we have a very populated village with a lot of people moving in and out, but having difficulties with parking being one of our biggest issues, which is traffic mitigation, a component of the traffic mitigation, anything from that.
Just to dovetail to those comments, we have had many conversations with the stakeholders, with the residents here in Farmingdale. We share their vision, but we have to do it while learning about the best practices from places like Farmingdale and Patchogue and other communities that have gone through this sort of renaissance. And in terms of keeping the look and feel of the Hicksville downtown. For instance, we met with the governor's team, the MTA, to get more brick included in the look and give
have that, and you know, you have 15,000 to 16,000 meters going to the station, and you want to have the, all these things plus the residential component for the commuters, for the millenniums and all that. I think we have to go beyond 4 or 5 stories, because downtown by itself, you know, it's, I don't think it's going to maintain that sort of, you know, suburban feel. It has to be more urban sort of, you know, feel to it. So we need to go, we have to think beyond 5 stories, 6 stories, whatever, you know, those kind of things. Yes, it should blend in with the rest of the community, but I think that downtown itself should have, you know, not skyscraper and all that, but in order to incorporate all this housing and the millenniums and all that, so we have to go beyond that.
The scale is one of those things that we as architects are very sensitive to, you know, how to manipulate. And one of the things that we would like to have you help us understand better is, since we're looking to do a lot of different things, would it be best to concentrate and build tall in a small spot as opposed to spreading things out over a large spot?
I know that's not what the residents want.
You've got to watch that word tall.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah, let me jump in. I was going to be quiet, but we've been through this 6-7 years, a whole lot of us, and I, 3- and 4-story buildings in that zone, you know, 500-600 units, whatever, you know, they really don't want to be, you heard it. Rose said it, Rebecca said it, Tony said it, others said it. Folks don't want to be Mineola, but they really do like Farmingdale, and the issue, too, is rebuilding trust. That the first few projects need to be of a scale and a quality that benefits everybody, so that folks see genuine change versus plans on top of plans on top of plans for a lot of years. And the final comment I'd make that is also critical, and I think I did like Highline and public spaces have all been through the process that we've seen funded for residents through the years. It's also improving street level conditions for walkability. It's key, because no matter what, you're not going to get everybody. How impressive the facility is. You're going to have street level people walking, biking, and trying to cross, and you need to improve those conditions to have a road functioning down there. I think we hear this stuff regularly from people on the street and people at the meetings. So we just want to make sure that the scale works, there's safety, and that there's overall improvement in the way that we've heard from the public. But you'll hear more of that in the zone.
Most definitely. One excerpt I've heard from everybody. John, do you have a
I agree with everyone. It's not just a negative statement, but I would definitely be like to have a better product. European style building, 4 or 5 stories, fine. We can have a high-end apartment, high-end stories, and nice restaurants, so family can go there, eat, or nice pedestrian area, the little style. I've seen the Farmingdale, which is beautiful, and a lot of other places also make the same thing. I think that will bring more attraction to that. But we have to look into the traffic, which is very important. So, bus idea, I like it. It will make more feature buses. It could be like a shuttle, or it could be like $1 or $2. That will reduce a lot of cars coming from places. The people that park in the area, especially the community, a lot of people, they go to the city and all that. So you will see a lot of high-end people that will be moving in the area, especially if we have a high-end apartments, like in that area, nice shopping.
John,
is there a
comment
you'd
like to
add?
I was lost after 5 stories. Sorry, that's not the feel of Big Show.
me understand a little bit better since I'm learning about this place. Where could you point me to in Hicksville where there is that pedestrian feel or the way that people move from store to store?
Inside the malls.
You had that feeling back in the 60s, state DOT wide Broadway and Woodbridge and isolated, actually destroyed the downtown area and isolated it. That's when you started seeing the exodus of the businesses and more, as Bill pointed out, surface parking lots being put in when businesses closed. So that, you know, you had that feel back in the 60s. I grew up in Hicksville, and my friends and I used to walk from our house about a mile into the downtown area. We'd go to the movie, we'd go to the dump, the bakery, we walked the church. So you had that feeling before Broadway and the Woodbridge were wide and just basically destroyed the downtown.
So if you were to identify today where downtown Hicksville is, what would you say this location is?
Storefront and residential apartments above it. So there's, that was part of the focus of the committee, in changing the zoning to bring back that feeling. You have store owned ownership and you have apartments or condos or townhouses above it. And then that way you do get people living in the downtown area being able to work in Manhattan, walk to the train station. I live in the Duffield Park area. I used to walk to the train stations. And I'm only half a mile from but people don't do that anymore. It's like Duffy Avenue is a lot of traffic, and it's sometimes it's a little bit dangerous to walk that
up. It's funny because if you look at the pictures from years ago, you had the stores, the apartments above it. Yeah. And then you look at a recent picture, it's gone. It's a parking lot, or it's one building. One of the additions, I think it was Fish Long Island came up, it used to go right back to the way it was before. Just a different format. Updated, newer. We're not going to bring back what it was like in the 60s in total. But again, where we can, it should be able to say, okay, yes, this is downtown Hicksville, and have that ability because businesses are going to benefit. People are going to spend money. They're going to live there. They're going to keep an eye out for the area. Things are going to automatically be moved out, and people are going to respect where they live.
This is a town outside of Charlotte, North Carolina, where it's first floor is restaurant stores, second one's offices, third and fourth are apartments or condos. Something like that would be perfect. If people would be able to get into the city if they want to bring business back into Hicksville.
Yeah. There's a great YouTube video called But the Cars Were Happy about all the decisions that were made from the 60s and that kind of time to widen the roads, creating more space for them. All the decisions to sprawl further outward because everybody had cars and were driving further to make these different lifestyles realities themselves. And I agree, going back in the direction for mixed-use space, mixed-use zoning is the only answer, especially for people my age. That's what we want. So we go to Huntington and walk around all those places. We'll drive a crazy hour out of the way to Long Beach just to get that feel. It would be awesome to do that there.
Just another follow-up. Another follow-up on the farming deal, and this goes off to one of the comments that Eric made. It's respecting the trust of the community and rebuilding that trust. One of the things that made farming deal successful with regard to the community was that the community said, we don't want five-story, four-story buildings. And we have some four-story buildings in farming deal. And then they built up the village, and it's tight in the village of farming deal. The board recognized that it was only right to approve projects that were essentially three-story buildings, and they kept within that. The community's been very receptive to it. We're one of the most densely populated municipalities as far as apartments are concerned. And it does seem to be working, but it's having the right project at the right speed in redoing it. And the proof is in putting. I mean, the village now has almost a zero occupancy rate with regard to the
natural area is that, like, the sweet shop, you've got the donut, like, there is a natural center of commerce, but I think what everyone is saying is you can't get from there to the hub, the train station, without taking your life in your hands. So I think in terms of, you know, what the focal area is, that's just my opinion. I'm sure other people at this table have 30 other opinions. But I know you were looking specifically for a sort of a geographic boundary. I don't know what anyone else thinks, but I mean, I could tell you for all the Pixel people, I mean, the sweet shop is the sweet shop. People can go to the sweet shop forever. And one of the things when they first came to the meeting that, you know, we're not going to lose the owners of the sweet shop, and we promised them, no, you know, not to worry about that. But you're right, this place for all of you. You go there, you go to the movies. I mean, I don't see a hard day tonight, 57 times. Because you could stay in that movie theater all day and see it 6 times in a row. You know, exactly.
I did the same thing with the French Connection.
But you would go and you would, you know, we had our downtown. And now, I mean, I have to refer to it now. You know, I mean, do I take you for this? Yes, but you know what? I figure out where I can park it. I'm not walking up and down that area because it's a main road with heavy traffic and trucking and, you know, it's, I think, like Rebecca said, you know, I see us sort of having to kind of reinvent our downtown, our focal area where we have, you know, the High Line, where we have pedestrian plaza, where we have places that we can enjoy in an area, and you know, possibly somehow making whether Sunday is off or over a road or something like that.
There are two things I'd like to do before we conclude at 10:30. One is to say some housekeeping and establish what our next steps will be for our regular meetings for the OPC. But also I'd like to invite the public who has generously decided to spend the time with us today as observers to actually comment on some of the things that we've been talking to. So at this point, let me just open it up to the general public for their comment. Sir, you just state your name.
Yes, John Moringer. I'm with the Hicksville Garden Civic Association. I've been a member of, well, a resident of the Hicksville for going on many, many years. I've heard a lot of comments about where we are, and I think that has an important point to be made in the status of Hicksville right now. Where is this town? And this town is all over the map. It's followed directions over the past 50 years, being pulled in one direction and the other by various projects that have existed over the years. The Mid-Island Mall, as most people, I would call it, the Broadway Mall today, the lack of Sears today, the lack of Grumman today, all of these issues have forced Hicksville one way or the other. The burning down of the was it called, the flea market over there.
Farmers Market.
That was a big thing in Hicksville. Farmers Market was a great draw for a lot of people. They came to visit this place. It burned down. The mall was great when it really existed in its heyday. It doesn't do well anymore because it It's lost most of its anchor stores. They exist, but they're not really putting money into their. Macy's doesn't even have doors that open automatically. You have to push them to get in. Sears is dead. You know, this place is in a status of they don't know which way to go, which way to follow. The last anchor we had was before the state came in and destroyed the middle of the town by putting in 106, 107, and whatever else they decided had to be to built to and the railroad and along our railroad, I should add, to accomplish their goals, not the people of Hicksville's goals, the goals of these projects that they saw coming down the pike. Well, those projects came and went. They didn't work out. The Broadway Mall was no longer. Broadway Mall started out as one of the first major malls on Long Island. It didn't last because Roosevelt Field took over, 110 takes over, they attract higher level anchor stores, and they're existing now. And Long Island and, you know, the Mid-Island Mall died. And the Broadway Mall, it's not that great anymore. Chick-fil-A is drawing crowds like crazy over there. You can't get close to them. Now, so if you have
more,
I'm sorry.
We definitely, it sounds like we need more things that can attract a lot of people and find a way to position them in this downtown area that we're focusing on. Is that what I'm hearing you say?
I am.
But in the proper, the important fact is, first, decide what you want the town to look like in the future. And then decide these opportunities that come along, pick the ones that match your idea of what you'd like to see. And stop drawing things in that just happened. Oh, we're going to invest some money. We're going to develop. We're going to build Sears into a five-story apartment house. Is that really what we want? Has anybody really determined, is that our goal, or is that the developer's goal?
Developer's goal.
Well, sir, that's very sound advice, and that's particularly what the DRI process is about, is to establish the vision for what the citizens here in Hicksville would like to see, and then put into place a plan to encourage that kind of investment so it can be implemented. So I hope that you see things coming out of this process that you would like to support. Yes.
Hi, my name is Susan Petrosillo. I'm a member of the Hicksville Garden and Civic Association. I was part of the revitalization committee over the past years with Eric Alexander and
Still are.
I just wanted to say when we had the last two meetings over at the high school, we had almost 500 people there. We don't usually get 500 people come out in Hicksville for anything.
Exactly.
But they came out for this because they do want us to move forward. Our civic has 430 families, which is over 1,000 people, give or take. And what we took into consideration during all of these meetings is what the people of Hicksville want. Not what somebody else thinks we want, not what somebody else thinks is a good idea, but what the people here want to live with and be part of our communities every day. So when we talk about how many levels high a building should be, and they said, well, it's five stories, we know the people because we talk to them all the time in the civics and all the different civics. They don't want that. They're so adamant. I mean, we knew that, and we discussed it, and we said, well, suppose we bring it down to three or four. Is that something that you could live with? And I would say the vast majority said, yes, that's something we could do. They didn't want, and they didn't even be able to say Queens. We don't, we don't want Queens. We don't want Mineola. We're Hicksville. We have a history here. We don't need somebody else saying, oh, this is what Hicksville is going to do for many years. I've been here 37 years. And many times, you know, you kind of lose the say, well, it's never going to get
input from people who have lived in the area for many years. You know, and for me, not being a resident of Hicksville, obviously I come from a very different perspective, so I'm taking that into consideration as well. But also, I think one of the things that hit, and I think Rebecca also mentioned it when asked, is to really look at things from, you know, as much as we want the High Line and walking areas, and I think all that's amazing, is really to look at making sure we take this from the bottom up. And where do we put people in terms of where is our parking? Where are the structures? Looking at, I think, like you just said, the people who live here now and considering kind of their well-being and their health, you know, and how they're living and ensure they can continue living in a way that's even potentially better than they are living now. And I think Ryan really raised some significant points in terms of where we want to go and where the future actually is. And I think that inevitably, like any business, looking at where they need to go, you can't always do everything. And if there's, you know, specific kind of parameters that we need to fit on to, you know, and we say, okay, here are our goals and we want to get there, I think that will set the filters for what really needs to be done moving forward. And I think the truth is, and I think Rebecca also said it, like, you know, people don't want to hear it and, you know, it might not be even as relevant to me, but I think for the town development and bringing money in, it is, in a sense, millennials and giving them a place. I mean, people move in. I mean, think about Hoboken. You know, like when I had moved into the city, I mean, I lived in a dump because it was affordable, but, every, you know, tons of people just moved across to Hoboken because it was dirt cheap at the time. Because they were developing it, and they developed a downtown. They developed an area. Again, they could put bigger buildings in, but, and I think that that's, you know, they knew what they wanted, and they reached it. Anyway, so that's, you know, and I think, but again, like a WeWork, that's what everybody's doing now. You know, like, I just stopped working in the city. So now, I mean, I'm working from home, but to have, I think, that kind of community, Hicksville has a huge opportunity for it. But I really do think, ultimately, that if we don't look at it from making sure there's places to park, parking isn't just for people who live here. I could never get a parking spot because I had to put my kids on the bus, you know? So I think we need to be sure we still have those opportunities, you know, for people to have, you know, somewhere to go before we get to look at, you know, let's build a High Line, you know, let's get the infrastructure.
Thank you very much.
Hi, good morning. Mike Ruvalo with the Hicksville Chamber of Commerce.
Say it right.
Sorry,
Mr. President
of the Hicksville Chamber. They made me do it. So I have a business here in Hicksville. I live in a neighboring town of Syosset, so I'm coming in and out of Hicksville either for work or for personal reasons on the weekends. Hicksville has a ton to offer right now. Right, we have something, I think we have a combination of things that possibly almost no other town on Long Island has between the rail, the roads, the highways. It's really a unique situation. But the thing that makes a town thrive, right, are the ability to attract families and the quality of life that you can demonstrate in the town, which is where I think we're all trying to focus and try to rejuvenate. One of the things that everybody has said, and I think it's a key factor, is the aesthetics of the town. It's not an attractive place right now. The storefronts are a mishmash of new things and very, very old, dated-looking things. Not charming old, but, you know, unfortunately, dated old. The roads, which I understand the history of how they got there, are not pretty to drive through. You know, you have a lack of trees, they're dirty, they're just, you know, you drive through the town, it's not an attractive place. And I think that is a major area where we could boost the draw of the town to residents by making it a more attractive place to come through. For all of the work that's been done to make the roads as large as they are, traffic is a killer. On east, west, north, south, during the busy times of day, you can't get through. And my observation, because I'm on those roads every day, including weekends, it's a traffic pattern issue. The lights are designed to keep you from moving. And I think if you resolve the traffic patterns and you improve the throughput, those roads, A, will be less congested, and I think they'll be better in terms of safety. The commuter pedestrian safety issue is tremendous. I almost kill somebody every night when I'm driving home. The people that run across the road. Sorry?
Thank you for your failure.
But you know, I worry. It's a matter of time because the people are running across the road. They're coming from the city. They're in their dark suits. I have terrible eyesight to begin with. Forget about adding all of that. So that is, to me, a tremendous factor that we have to deal with, is the ability to safely cross the roads for the commuters, but also somebody mentioned, you know, crossways over the roads for the pedestrians. I think that that's going to be something that if you want people to walk around, they have the ability to walk around, and they're not going to get through the intersections. I mean, I just try to go from my store to 7-Eleven, literally the next corner, and I hope I have enough insurance. It's hard. And my last thought is and this is a toughie, the thing that really does draw families is open public spaces. I don't know enough about the High Line design to know if that's going to be the answer to that. I feel like people are more drawn to ground level spaces, things that they can walk to and see every day. But that is typically the kind of thing that will draw young people and families to a place.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for your comments. We appreciate hearing directly from people. It's important for our planning and design process. Now I'd just like to do a bit of housekeeping here. We selected today at 8:30 in the morning to start for this very first LPC meeting. But amongst the members, what day of the week, what time of day would you prefer?
My office has overwhelmingly heard from residents that would appreciate evening meetings so that they can attend.
Same here.
Okay. So starting 5:30, 6:30, 7 o'clock?
7 o'clock.
Is there a particular day of the week that you guys prefer?
Thursday.
I
would just make a comment on the night. A lot of this Hicksville Community Council meets on the first Thursday.
Right.
Hicksville Garden Civic meets on the second Thursday. You know, you have on a Monday night, the Lord's Blessings, the third week, third Monday. I'm not sure when Midland Civic
meets. So towards then.
My civic is kind of in the flux. We don't really have them met, but you know, have to be conscious of when the Civic Association meets. We're scheduling each meeting. Plus, when you schedule the public meeting. Now, next week, at your first public meeting, actually conflicts with the Hicksville Garden Civic Association meeting, where several members are here. And, you know, maybe you could have a very good turnout at that meeting.
Well, maybe that's not the terrible call. Maybe if people already have it on their calendars to come to a civic meeting, it's easy to say to them, hey, come to the community forum.
I'd like to hear from the civic people. That's
right. I think if you give people enough heads up, they can plan appropriately, because again, for me and the chamber trying to keep up with who's got what going on, it gets challenging. But if there's enough leeway, they can work something out.
Sounds like Tuesday night.
One other quick comment. State's website regarding the Hicksville BRI. On the first page, the date is fine for the next year is right, but if you click on it, it says annual stuff, they can change that. Got a lot of complaints about that also.
Okay, just want to take care of that.
Okay, thank
you. For the LPC meetings, that's what we're talking about now. When would the local planning committee meet regularly? Sounds like we're talking at 7 p.m. We're also looking at.
It's for this group. We're talking about the public. So it sounds like there's two different potential audiences.
I'd like to suggest that we pick a night for both. This way, you know, because it's like herding cats.
Yep.
And thinking, how about the third Thursday of the month?
Works for me.
Something like that.
Fine. Works for me. Same here.
At least if you have another organization that normally would appear then on a particular time of the meeting, give them the, you know, the opportunity for those meetings to change the location or whatever. Because I know the Garden City really just found out that the public meeting here on the same night was there.
Eric, we had talked earlier before we started about actually pushing this special meeting back a week because you need people in a time.
Public workshop or to the LPC meeting?
Well, the LPC meeting, we had, we set the next one up on a
5:30.
At 9.
That's a public workshop.
Public workshop. We talked about moving that meeting back a week earlier. I don't know. Seems like it's kind of short notice.
That'd be a good idea.
That would be the third Thursday.
Right, I think it's worth mentioning that something I believe ran in Newsday this morning announcing the public meeting.
Yeah, you don't want to switch it because it's already been out there. People were upset because of this one. And they were like, oh, okay, there's something going on the 9th. And I think people already.
The question is, it would certainly be nice to give the public more lead time. Mm-hmm. But is it more confusing now that it's been out? I didn't realize at the time it's been advertised on Newsday this morning.
I think it's been in Newsday. You should leave it for yes.
So what I'm hearing is that on Thursday for the local planning committee, the third Thursday of the month is where we think we should open meetings at 7 p.m. start time. The 16th of November. Yes, ma'am.
Wouldn't it be better Wednesday at 7? There's not that many conflicts. There's a lot of times Fridays.
To the local planning committee here to make that decision.
A suggestion.
Wednesday. So it stands still. Third Thursday of the month at 7 p.m. for the local planning. That in November, December, January, February, date?
I think, as Carrie just pointed out, I think the next third Thursday is Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
So
it is.
No.
Oh, is it? It's the fourth Thursday.
Okay.
Okay. Is handing out right now is a form that all members of the local planning committee need to sign and return to Gina. So if you want to take a moment or two to be over, we'll talk about signing the form. If not, take it home, read it.
Two big infrastructure issues are the railroad and the two state highways in around here. We've got good representation today from the railroad. I we could go around in circles with ideas. If we don't have their buy-in, it's going to be a problem.
Yeah, Dave, we do have a couple of contacts from DOT, and they will be attending the future.
Okay, good.
Does anybody have any final comments they would like to share with us today?
Yes. I'd like to thank everyone for participating. This is very important for the Renaissance in Hicksville, as well as the town of Oyster Bay. And I believe this is a very good start to something that will be a very productive process.
I want to thank everybody for taking their time this morning to join us. And in particular, I want to thank all the observers for coming. I know that, again, this is a awkward time for some people's schedule. So
do you have the charger
here? And I encourage everybody to participate at the next public workshop, which is on November 9th, still. Starting at 7 o'clock. Right here.
This is the button. Stop it.
So see you then. Thank you.